وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. So in the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we were at a time where we discussed the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Kisra, who was named, his actual name was Parvez, and his title was Kisra as the king of Persia. And out of pride and out of arrogance, he tore up the blessed letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and with the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam against him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed him. He was killed by his own son, and his empire starts to fall apart. And with the miracle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that we discussed in the last dars, where he told the two Persian soldiers sent by Bahdan upon the request of Kisra to Medina, that your elder, yani the king, has died last night. When there is no way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Medina could have known about a death that happened in Persia that even the people of Persia did not know about until later. So Bahdan, the governor of Yemen, or the parts of Yemen that were controlled by the Persians, when his two men came back to him and they said, this is what we heard in Medina, he said that if this news is true, then no doubt that this man is a true prophet. And when the son of Kisra took over the kingdom, Kisra, he was a very evil man in many ways, but he liked to, and I will translate, he liked to party. And he saw that his son and others were plotting. So what did he do? And I'm gonna. This is history. I mean, I read this from Ibn Kathir in Bidayah wa Nihaya, and Ibn Hajar has also mentioned it, and Ibn Sa'ad and others. But I'm gonna kind of hint towards things, and inshallah, those that need to get it will get it. So he was afraid that his sons were gonna assassinate him. So, and he knew that they also liked to party. So he had some medicine, he put on it that this is the medicine to help you in the way that a little blue pill from Pfizer helps people. So he put that, and then he put poison in it. He put, يعني المفيد للجماع, and then he put poison in it. So his son killed him, stabbed him, took over the kingdom, but then he also wanted to party, and he saw this, he thought it was going to be benefit. He drank it, he died from the poison as well. And this is why you see the disrespect to Islam, the disrespect to the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made him, so where he was destroyed and cursed, and his generations and his kingdom, and the Persians with all of the pride and kibar that they still carry today, their kingdom fell apart. I mean, the Romans, you will see that till today we're at it. But the Persians, couple of knocks, couple of big battles, they fell apart. And this is something important to understand out of understanding the respect for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also sent a letter to Hiraqal, who is the Qisra or Qaisar. Not Kisra, it's from Persia. Qaisar was the what's called in English Caesar, the kings of Rome. So like Kisra was not his actual name, that was a title. Najashi was not his actual name, that was a title. Kisra, we discussed his name already. Here, Qaisar is the title given, in English it's called Caesar, to anybody who ruled Rome. And Rome was not just the city of Rome, but the Roman Empire that controlled a large part of Europe and what's today, what's called Turkey and Sham. All of these areas were ruled by the Romans. So Qaisar was the title, and this particular one, his name is Hiraqal. Hiraqal, as Ibn Hajar Asqalani, he says, Al-Hiraqal huwa malik al-Rum, wa huwa bi kasrat al-ha, wa fathat al-ra, wa sukun al-qaf. He was a pious king, and he was a king who was a staunch follower of what he thought to be the religion of Isa alayhi salam, yani Christianity. And even though the Christian faith had been corrupted by this time, but he tried his best to follow it. And he was also a scholar. Hiraqal, who was ruling the Roman Empire at the time, he was a scholar of the earlier texts. It's very important to understand. And he had studied what studying the stars and taking omens and studying like the palm, which things are haram in Islam. But he had studied these sciences as well. And there are many ahadith that point towards what he was going through. Many of them are da'if, so I'm leaving those out. What we find in the Sahih ahadith, as we find Ibn Kathir and others have mentioned, that Hiraqal at this time had won from the Persians. And the Quran pointed towards the battle between the Romans and Persians and what would happen. And out of wanting to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Hiraqal made a nadr, or an oath, that he would walk from Constantinople, which is today called Istanbul, from there all the way to Baytul Quds, yani Baytul Masjid al-Aqsa, which is in Al-Quds. So he made this nadr that he would walk on his feet, carrying what they believe to be the cross that Isa alayhi salam was crucified on. As we know in Islamic belief, we don't believe that. Khair. So he made this nadr that if Allah gave him victory over the Persians, he would do this. He got victory over the Persians, as the Quran had mentioned. And he was fulfilling that nadr. He was going from Constantinople all the way to what's today called Jerusalem, Al-Quds. And on his way, when he was going on foot, the people from the different towns were coming out, putting flowers under his feet, greeting him. He was known to be a good man. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this time sent one of the great Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. And all of the Sahaba are great, but many of the Sahaba are not well known to us. Dahiya bin Khalifa al-Kalbi, from the famous Banu Kalb tribe. Dahiya radiallahu anhu was a very brave Sahabi, known to be a great warrior as well. He has a great history to study, but we don't have time for that here. But he was given the letter from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to go to Hiraqal and give him this letter of da'wah toward Islam. Dahiya radiallahu anhu was known to be very handsome. In some of the ahadith, some of them being mawquf and others towards marfu', he is called the Yusuf alayhi salam of our ummah. What does that mean? Yusuf alayhi salam was known for being handsome. And Dahiya radiallahu anhu was very handsome. So he was called the Yusuf of this ummah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam entrusted him with a letter. But to get to Al-Qaisar was very difficult. To get to the Caesar or the king was very difficult. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, through his hikmah, he told him to go to the one who was the ruler of Basra, or Busra, which is in Sham. Basra is in Iraq. Busra was in Sham. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, go to the ruler of Busra, and when you get there, then give him the letter, and he will facilitate you getting to Al-Qaisar. The ruler of Busra, his name was Harith, and he was from the Ghassan tribe. The Ghassan tribe were an Arab people. They were ethnically Arab, but they were Christians. Until today, you will find them in Sham, in Jordan, in these areas. Dahiya radiallahu anhu, he went to Busra, he gave the letter, and Harith, who was a Christian ruler, he took the letter to the Qaisar. While he was on that path, going from Constantinople to Al-Quds. Now, Qaisar, or Hiraqal, he was an intelligent man. Unlike Kisra from Persia, Parvez, he didn't just rip up the letter or ask. Instead, what did he do? Is that he wanted to investigate about this man, yani Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, there are some ahadith like Ibn Hibban and others have mentioned, and there is some kalam on the asanid, there is some da'af in them. But they are mentioned historically that he had seen some signs that the next prophet was coming. And he was expecting that.
Sisters. Sisters. Everybody on YouTube is wondering right now why I'm stopping. And everybody sitting here realizes it's because you're talking.
So here, Hirqal, he said to Harith, the ruler of Busra, that before I listen to this da'wah, I want to know about this man. So find anybody from his people that are under my kingdom and bring them to me. Now these narrations, many of them are in Bukhari and Muslim. These are all from Sahih Ahadith. So when they started to look for anybody from the people of Hijaz or Mecca in Gaza, who did they find? They found Abu Sufyan and the Quraysh. Now subhanallah, at this time Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu is not a Muslim. And the Quraysh have a hostile relationship with the Muslims. So this was, if you look at it from a purely worldly perspective, a very bad thing. Because now this king, when he asked, for example, may Allah protect us all, but let's say me and somebody are in a heated debate, or we are enemies on some issue, and then somebody finds them and asks them about me, obviously they're going to say bad things because they're an enemy. And here Abu Sufyan and the Quraysh, even though they have the Sulh of Hudaybiyah, but they are almost at war. So Abu Sufyan is somebody who is going to give a negative impression about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But that is from a worldly perspective. But we think from a perspective that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote the qadr, and he wrote what is best. So here, as we find in Sahih al-Bukhari and others, that Hirqal didn't speak Arabic, but he requested a translator to be brought. Abu Sufyan and the delegation from Quraysh were seized, they were forcefully brought to Sham to be in front of Hirqal. And Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, because he becomes a Muslim later, he actually narrates a hadith himself. And there are other asanid as well. It's a strong hadith in al-Bukhari and other books. But he mentions a story himself. He says that when we were taken, we had no choice because we were in the Roman Empire. The Romans were very strong, we were a superpower of the time. And we had to go. And when the translator told us before meeting Hirqal that you're going to be asked about this man named Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Sufyan, he says that if I could have, I thought I'm going to lie. Yani I'm going to speak bad about him because we're at war. But Hirqal was an intelligent man. What did he do? When he brought everybody together, he asked which one of you is closest in relation to this man, yani Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now Abu Sufyan, he was the closest relative of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this delegation. So he said, I am. He told him, okay, you come close. What did he tell him? You come close to me and sit close to me. And the rest of your delegation sit behind. And if this man lies to me, I want you guys to make an ishara, make a symbol. Now Hirqal is very intelligent because now Abu Sufyan can't see behind him. So if he says a lie and somebody makes an ishara, Abu Sufyan won't know. So Abu Sufyan radiyallahu anhu, later when he narrates the hadith, he says, I had the intention to lie, but I couldn't because I was afraid that I would become known amongst the Arab as a liar. And subhanAllah, this tells you a few things. And one of the things this tells you, that Hirqal was an intelligent man. Second thing it tells you, that Abu Sufyan was a man of honor. Yani the Arab, they were concerned about their reputation and their honor, which is a good sifa. Even if they're not doing it mukhlisan, but at least they cared. Today, you know, in many cultures, somebody will lie openly and people will know him to be a liar and nobody cares. They will lie like it's nothing. And their reputation means nothing to them. They're not people of honor. But the Arab, they cared. So here, now Abu Sufyan is sitting up front and he said, now I had no ability to lie. I had to tell the truth, even when I didn't want to. And the rest of the Quraysh are sitting behind, and Hirqal, he begins questions through a translator. فَقَالَ الْهِرَقَلُ كَيْفَ نَسَبُهُ هَذَا الرَّجُلُ فِيكُمْ. And how is his nasab? How is his lineage? Now Abu Sufyan, he wants to be truthful. فقال وهو فينا ذو نسب. يعني he's a رجل, he has نسب. Now many of us will not understand this because we are not raised in tribal societies. But those of you that may have been raised in tribal societies, you know that your lineage is important. Why? Because when somebody comes to you, they are concerned about their honor, not to bring disgrace on their family. Some of the people, may Allah forgive us, I mean, even in our ummah today, they have no concern. Like their child will be doing the most fahsh thing and they'll be laughing about it. But in other places where the family structure is better, even if somebody is wanting to do something bad, sometimes because of the honor of the family and the parents, they stay in check. So here the Arab were like this. So this is the first question he asked. Now Hiraqal doesn't explain why he's asking the questions, but he does later on. So you have to wait for the later part of the hadith. So here he asks him, how is his nasab? How is his lineage? So Abu Sufyan says he's a person of lineage. Yani he is somebody from a honorable family, a good lineage. Tayyib. Then he asks him, فَهَلْ قَالَ هَذَا قَوْلْ مِنْكُمْ أَحَدٌ قَبْلَهُ قَطْ. يعني had somebody said this, يعني claimed to be a prophet before him ever in your tribe? And that's very important. One of the, and we discussed this earlier in the Sirah Durus, for those of you that were here early. One of the ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the message was there was nobody from amongst the Arab that claimed prophethood before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many of them claimed different things. Some of them claimed they were the best of shu'ara on the face of the earth. If you ever, when you study the Arabic language in depth, you study the poetry from the Asr of Jahiliyyah, from the time, and you will find a lot of pride. Like they will say, there's no poet that ever lived like me and my tribe and this. But they never claimed prophethood. And that's important because this was not somebody imitating, it was not a copycat, it was not somebody that was like here many times in our ummah today, you'll see somebody, I'm Isa ibn Maryam. And they usually, you'll find a lot. I've met 3-4 of them myself. I'm Isa ibn Maryam. No, you're not, man. Just sit down, relax. I'm Isa ibn Maryam. No, trust me. I'm Mahdi. Read some Arabic. Alhamdulillah. No. So, now the issue is, if somebody makes a lot of claims, somebody else making the claim, everybody says it's whatever. But this was unique. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent in a time protected, where nobody had this da'wah. So he asked this, Abu Sufyan said la, that nobody has made this claim before him, he had to tell the truth. Then Hiraqal asked that, وَهَلْ كَانَ مِنْ أَبَائِهِ مِنَ الْمَلَكٍ. Yani was any of his generations or his earlier ancestry from the kings? Like was his father or grandfather or great-grandfather a king? Abu Sufyan said la, because the Arab society had no kings. At that time they had tribes and they had tribal elders. They had tribes and tribal elders, but they had no kings, and they were not organized enough to be a kingdom. The Persians somewhat ruled them, but not even directly, because they thought of them to be nothing. They thought of the Arab to be very low, not even worthy of being ruled. The Persians had kings, the Romans had kings, but the Arabs didn't. So he said no. Hiraqal continued. He asked, for those that follow him, are they the Ashraf, the most honored, or are they the du'afa? Are they the weak and the poor? So here, Abu Sufyan, he had to tell the truth. He said, Bal, hum min al-du'afa. Yani they are the weak that follow him. Hiraqal continued. He said, are they increasing or decreasing? Now Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, later on he says, I wanted to say something different, but I had to tell the truth. I said, they're increasing. Hiraqal said, continue. He said, has any of them become a murtad or left their religion out of a hatred for the religion itself? Now it's a very important and well-worded question. How? Even if you look in our ummah today, Alhamdulillah, ثُمَّ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ, by the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't see a lot of Muslims leaving Islam. And if there is a Muslim, not one of those fake YouTube videos, But if there is a Muslim that leaves Islam, they will be either the most ignorant of Muslims, or they will be for some worldly gain. It will not be a hatred for Islam itself. Yani you don't see, alhamdulillah, from any of our major ulama, from the Lajna, or from the ulama of this Muhaddithun, leaving the religion. But you do see big preachers, and bishops, and priests, and rabbis, and Hindu pundits becoming Muslim. And you will see the most learned of Christians, and Jews, and Hindus, and Rastafarians becoming Muslim. But you will never see that the other way. And this is important because sometimes a person will leave the religion because they didn't know the religion anyway. Sometimes will they leave the religion because in their heart they loved the dunya, they didn't have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when Iman enters the heart truly, you don't see them leaving Islam. And this was true in the time of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhu. The harshest enemies against Islam were becoming Muslim. The leaders of Quraysh were becoming Muslim. The intellectual preachers of the Yahud were becoming Muslim. But you didn't see one major Sahabi becoming a Murtad. And in our time, the same thing. And that's why it's important for the Muslims to gain knowledge, to build that Iman, to build that love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because just your name being Muhammad or Abdullah or Ahmad is not enough. You have to develop that Iman. And once you do, مُخْلِسًا لِلَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى, then Allah will keep you. May Allah preserve us all. So here Abu Sufyan, he says, no, nobody is leaving the religion from such a people. So here Hiraqal, he continues. He says, فَهَلْ كُنْتُمْ, يعني, have any of you accused him بِالْكَدَبْ قَبْلَ ذَلِكْ, before this, has he ever been accused of being a liar? And Abu Sufyan, he says, لا. And he has never been accused of being a liar. And that also tells us the importance of being truthful. This was one of the sifat of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he was always truthful. Before Islam and after Nabuwah, the same truthfulness. And that's why here, even if Abu Sufyan wanted to give a negative image, he had to speak the truth. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had never been accused of being a liar. Then he asked, have you fought him? Yani, have you, the Quraysh, fought him? Abu Sufyan said, yes. He says, how are the battles between you and them? Now, we know in the seerah that the battles were almost unanimously won by the Muslims. But Abu Sufyan, he said, there are days for them and there are days for us. And Abu Sufyan later says that there are few things I tried, and this was one of them, but it didn't work. Hiraqal continued. He says, فَهَلْ يَغْدِرْ, does he betray his word? Abu Sufyan said, la. No. That's very important. Because if you ask an average non-Muslim today that did business with a Muslim, and does the Muslim betray their word, they will say, yep. And this is sad for us as Muslims, not following the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once he made an appointment with somebody, he went there, the person didn't show up, for 3 days he waited there. 3 days and three nights he waited there. And when he saw the man on accident, he didn't say, what, you didn't keep your word? None. He just told him, you made this a hardship on me. That's it. But he fulfilled his word. That's how precise and how concerned Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with fulfilling his word. So here Abu Sufyan also said he didn't. But Abu Sufyan, now he's an enemy, he says, but they're in the sulha with us right now, maybe he'll betray it in the future. He's trying. And Abu Sufyan says himself, radiallahu anhu, that later, that I was trying, but Hiraqal didn't pay attention to it. Then Hiraqal asked, فَمَاذَا يَأْمَرُكُمْ, what does he order you to? What does he tell you to do? So Abu Sufyan, even wanting not to tell the truth, he had to tell the truth, he said, أَنَّعْبَدُ اللَّهَ wahda. It's very important. What did he begin with? That the Prophet ﷺ orders us to pray and worship only one Allah. Now this man, Abu Sufyan, at this time is not a Muslim, but he understands the message of Islam better than many of us. Why? Today somebody will be a mushrik. And I'm not talking about fiqh, ikhtilaf and things, but a mushrik. Somebody who will go to a qabr and tell the one from the qabr, oh Wali, give me a child. Or they will say, oh Ali, you are the mushkil khusha, you are the one that solves the problem. And our imma today, they tell us, don't talk about these things. It's okay, unity. We are not isna, we are, what is it? Ithna ashar. Because right now, for political reasons, we need to put these aqidah things to the side. Tawheed. You guys are always talking about tawheed. Let's talk about politics. But this is not Islam. The main thing and the first thing in Islam is a tawheed. So, here he mentioned this. And then he continues, وَلَا نُشْرِكْ بِهِ شَيْئًا. And he orders us not to make shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with anything. And those people, they want to make tawassul with the dead and things, understand that the Quraysh didn't deny Allah. When you ask them who created the samawat and the earth, they said, Qalu Allah. But they wanted to make tawassul through their idols, through their saints, through who they had before them to get to Allah. So this was their shirk. Now, he continued that he gives us an order, bis salah, to pray, or bis sidq, to be honest, and to take care of the weak, and to honor the parents, and all the good things that we find in Islam. When he finished, Hiraql now explains to him why he asked what he asked. And I'm summarizing between the narrations from Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and I'm mentioning some of what Ibn Hajar and An-Nawi and others have mentioned in their shuruh, these books, and that which is reported in the Musnad and Al-Hakim and others. But only what is mentioned in Sahih Ahadith. Hiraql explains that he says that when I asked you about his nasab, I asked you because I know from our books that Allah has sent the Anbiya with good nasab for the people to respect. So I asked you this first. He said, second, I asked you whether his fathers were kings, because if his father had been a king or his father, I would have said, maybe he's trying to preserve his kingdom. You know, the kings, they always want to say they're divine. You know, there is a man, his name was King James. King James. If you go to a Christian nowadays, most of them, and you ask for an English version of the Bible, and you open the first page, it'll say King James Version. King James was a king of England that was known as the Queen of England. And you can guess why. He was very friendly with animals in ways you shouldn't be friendly with animals. I'm not going to elaborate. You can read up on yourself. But he claimed to be divine. And he changed and translated and edited the Bible. And today such a man, I'm not going to go in detail, you can research it yourself. Christians have taken him to be an authority for the Bible they have. And every king, from Arthur, from, you know, Richard, the cowardly heart, whatever, they all claimed a divine right. Look at the Dalai Lamas. Not the Peruvian Lama. The Dalai Lama. They say, we are a walking, living God. A'udhu billah. He gets sick, he can't cure himself. He can't even free himself from China. He's running in England hiding. But he's a living God. I guess the Chinese government is stronger than their living God. So, but you see, the kings, to preserve their kingdom, they always want to give this divine aspect to it. And that's why Hiraql asked this question. And the Quraysh, when they answered no, he said, I knew that this was not somebody trying to preserve their kingdom. He said, I asked you if you'd been known to lie, because I know that Allah would not send a messenger who was a liar. It's very important. Then he says, I asked you whether his followers were strong and the most honored from the biggest families or the weak and poor. Because I know from Isa alayhi salam that the people who follow the messengers are the weak and poor. And he says, I asked you whether they're increasing or decreasing. Because this is the way of Iman, that it increases when the Nabi is there. So I knew that his followers, if he is a true Nabi, they would be increasing. Then he asked about being any of them becoming murtad, leaving the religion. He said, I asked this because I knew from the example of Iman, and he mentioned the word Iman in his language. He said, when it is fresh, then it cannot leave the heart because of the religion. You will may have other reasons, but not for that. And he explained this as well. He said, then I asked you about the betrayal from this man. Because I know الرسل لا يغدر. The messengers, they do not betray their word. And I asked you about the battles, because this is what I find from all of the earlier Anbiya, that they have victories and losses. لكن العاقبة لهم. يعني the end will be for them. He told Abu Sufyan this. And then he says, I asked you, what does he order you to do? Because I read the Injil and the Torah and the writings before it. And I knew what Allah ordained the earlier Anbiya to order. And I find that what this man orders you to do is what a messenger would order his nation. Then he says, فَإِنْ كَانَ تَقُولْ حَقًّا. If what you are saying to be true, he's telling Abu Sufyan, that if what you're saying is true, فَسَيَمْلَكْ, he will rule الْمُعْدِ قَدَمَيْهِ هَاتَيْنِ. He says, if what you're saying is true, then soon this man, يعني Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, will rule the land, يعني the place that my two feet are upon. يعني الشام. There is a lot, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and others, they discuss this in great detail. I'm going to summarize. The first thing here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a hikmah that we don't see. When we thought that the only one they found was Abu Sufyan and the Quraysh, we thought this would be bad because he's going to give a bad da'wah. But here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving da'wah to Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, later he became Muslim, and this incident is one of the means. Because he's hearing from Hirqal that this man is a true messenger and he will rule this area. And Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu himself says, as we've seen in the letter hadith, he says, I knew after that day that this religion would spread all over the world. And then he tells him, this is also a sign. In the longer version of the hadith, as Hakim and the Muslims have mentioned, he says that the Anbiya have three characteristics that they have pointed out for the last prophet. That the earlier prophets, now this man has never met Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he's saying they've given three characteristics. That he will come out of a city, and he described it like Makkah. And he says, then he will leave, make hijrah to a city that has trees, which is Al-Madinah. And he says, he will rule the land of Sham. And that's what we find with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Ummah as it comes. Now, what does Hirqal say now? Hirqal says that if I could go to this man, I would wash his feet. Subhanallah. Hirqal says, if I could go to him, I would wash his feet. Now the question, why can't Hirqal go to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Is it that far? No. Dahiya radiallahu anhu, he came, right? Is it that he's sick or unable? No, he's walking from Constantinople to Al-Quds. So he's physically able, but why not? Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani discusses this, and he says, the kingdom was a fitna for him. The kingdom was a fitna for him. And this is why many of us, we make dua, oh Allah, give me wealth. Oh Allah, make me the president or ruler or khalifa or amir or this or that. Be careful what you ask for. Ask Allah for khair. Because sometimes, if you become the leader, and I'm telling you, you know, if you become the imam of a masjid, let alone the leader of a city or a country, it'll be such a fitna for you, will ruin your iman. The kingdom was a fitna for him. If he was not a king, he could have gone. Alhamdulillah, I'll tell you something. I was with a sheikh, a very, very knowledgeable, may Allah make his umur easy for him, sheikh. And we were going somewhere, just me and him. Nobody else. No guards, nobody, in a very rough environment. And he said, I feel like making two rak'ah, and just sitting there making dua, thanking Allah that I'm not famous. So you know why? He said, if I was famous, I couldn't be going like this with you, eating wherever we want, going to a masjid, making salah, and getting out. Because when you become famous, or if you're a king, or if you're somebody wealthy beyond means, you can't even move anywhere. Security and worries, and you look at people hiding in towers and worried about their you know, security detail before they can go out and go to the bathroom and things. What a life is that? Hilaqal, if he was an ordinary man, he saw this, he could have gone to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, become from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, had that honor, had that Jannah, he could have had it, but he had this fitna of being a king. But Hilaqal, he wrote back to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in this there is a lot of khilaf of ulama. I'm going to summarize what we find in some of the ahadith. Is in his letter back, he wrote a great praise for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he wrote inni musliman, yani I am a Muslim. But other ulama like Ibn Hajar and others have mentioned that he didn't become Muslim. What we do find is Hiraql, he took the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now look at the difference between him and Kisra Parviz from Persia, who ripped it up. Hiraql took the letter and he honored it, and he put it in velvet, which was very expensive at the time. And he told his children, now look at this ajib. We look at the honor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sometimes we say things and people think you're Sufi or something just because of our love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Loving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the way of the Salaf al-Salihin, not the way of some misguided sect. You know, the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, many of the Sahaba in authentic ahadith, they wanted it put on their eyes and mouths at the time of death. And as did Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal and others, because the blessed body of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now I don't mean the fake relics that we have today. Somebody comes in a masjid right now, I have the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where did you get the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? $10 million, I'll sell it to you. Jazakallah khair, you know, have some tea, go home. So, but if something is really from the body of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no doubt this is something where there is barakah. So here, this is not from the body, it's a letter. But Hiraql, he honored it. He didn't tear it up. And he told his children that as long as you have this with you, you will rule. Ajib. Ibn Hajar Asqalani writes that one of my teachers, he went to the Roman areas. And he met a Roman king who told him, do you want to see the letter of your prophet? Now Ibn Hajar Asqalani, we're talking about 700-800 years later. But he said the Roman king still had the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The paper had degraded, but the writing was legible, and he said, I read it. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani wrote about this himself. So the Romans, unlike the Persians, at least they honored the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah preserved them to rule at least on their people. Now, Hiraql here, he honored the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sent a very positive response back. And what we find in some of the Sahih narrations mentioned in the historic books is that Hiraql called all his knowledgeable people, yani the priests and his wazir, you know, those that were his advisors. He called them all together and he gathered them and he told them, he read to them the letter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told them that this man is a true prophet. And what he has called towards is the truth, and we should accept it. And at that time, those people that love the dunya, you know, the people that love the dunya, they realize that if you accept this da'wah, their dunya is going to scatter. They're going to have to become people of zuhud. You know, today, even if you look at the Catholic Church today, I met a person who was not Muslim. He was an Iraqi Christian. And he used to work at the Vatican, where the Pope's at, the red shoes. And he said, in the Vatican, there are floors under the ground that I saw myself. But what they had done, they had taken a saint, quote unquote, saint. And they had put him in a refrigerated chamber. And he says, my job used to be to go back to where the refrigeration was and change out the tanks and fix the pipes and things. And he says they would bring people from villages, people from Eastern Europe and Africa, and they would not tell them that we have frozen him. They would tell him, look at him, he's a saint. His body is not deteriorating. And he says, we would laugh at it because we knew this was a lie. But they would tell this lie to fool the people. This is a Christian telling me this. And he told me that I went to floors where billions of dollars, billions with a B, worth of artifacts, gold, paintings, things that they had taken from the Germans during World War II were stored. It's all about that money. Why can't Catholic priests marry? Because the church didn't want their inheritance to go to their children. It's all about that wealth. Same thing was here. These people, when they realized that if we become Muslim, we can't rip the people off anymore. We can't fool them like these 700 club, what is that, 700 club? Fake evangelical, whatever, come on TV. I need $10 million. What do you need $10 million for? If you're a person who follows Isa alayhi salam in his zuhud, you don't need anything. So they started shouting and screaming and they went out. Now Hiraqal had the doors closed so they couldn't leave, but the commotion, it worried Hiraqal. It takes a strong vessel to contain iman and ilm. And Hiraqal here, he became afraid for his kingdom. He thought that if I go and become Muslim, these people will revolt against me, my kingdom will fall apart. And at that time, he pulled a quick trick and he told him, I was just testing you guys. Just kidding. It was a joke. I was just testing how firm you are on your religion. And everybody's like, oh, okay. Why were you saying those Wahhabi things? You should have just told. Sorry. You know, like this happens today too sometimes, you know. You go somewhere, you tell them, you know, this grave can't really do anything for you. And they get those sticks out. Oh, you're like, no, just kidding. Just kidding. I was just testing how much you love the awliya, you know. They're like, oh, okay. You didn't become Wahhabi. No. Oh, you're okay. Same things happen. I met ulema. I'm telling you personally. I met ulema that met with me and told me, you know what? This, what you're saying is right. Told him, but you just taught the opposite to it in your dars. Because if I say what you say in my dars, they will not make me imam here anymore. You know, we meet people. There's a brother who used to text me and email me questions. But then he would say, don't tell anybody that I ask you questions because if my friends find out, then I'm off the manhaj. You know? He's probably watching a video somewhere. He'll remember what it is. You know? He watches the videos. He sends me questions. But he tells me, don't tell anybody because my masjid, close to Federal Avenue, if they're there, then they're going to make fun of me. SubhanAllah, if you care about the haqq, don't care about anybody else. Don't care what people say. Don't care about the kingdom. Don't care about money. Don't care about status. Speak the truth. Hiraqal is a lesson for us. A man who knew the message to be true. But what we find from the majority of the ulama, they say he didn't become a Muslim. And what is the proof for that? Is that he fought the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and later on in the Ghazwatul Mu'tah and other places. So, because of the fact that he himself led armies against the Muslims, the stronger opinion is that he never became a Muslim, but he knew Islam to be the truth. Maybe in his heart he died a Muslim, Allah knows best. We leave that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, I want to mention some very important points about Abu Sufyan here. Abu Sufyan, he says himself, he says, that day, after listening to Hiraqal, my heart started to open up to Islam. Because I saw somebody who was not Arab, who's not from our tribes, recognize this man, yani Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to be a true prophet. And I thought, why is it that we who know him better, who know his honesty better, we know his truthfulness better, why do we not recognize him as a true prophet? Now, Dahya ibn Khalifa al-Kalbi radiallahu anhu, he had delivered his letter. He started to go back towards Medina. On his way back, he got attacked by a tribe, Banu Judham. And this tribe was a tribe that was known as bandits. And when they attacked, they took his wealth. And there were Muslims in that area that had become Muslim that went to defend him. But they were overpowered by them. And they took his wealth. And they took everything that he has. Even his outer garments. But they didn't kill him. He made it back to Medina. And when he got to Medina, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw him, he asked him what happened. Dahiya radiallahu anhu, he told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, immediately the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had that ghira for Muslims. Today something bad happens to our brothers or even our sisters and our heart doesn't even feel it. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, immediately he dispatched Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu with 500 mujahideen to go out and attack this tribe to take revenge for harming a Muslim. And they went and they attacked the tribe and they won. They killed many of them. There was a battle and alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Muslims victory and they took from them ghanima, their animals and belongings and things. And they brought the honor back to show that Muslims are not to be messed with. And when they came back to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those that were Muslims and had defended Dahiya radiallahu anhu, when they came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave them back everything they had and showed protection. To show that Muslims are not concerned about wealth, we are concerned about honor and right and wrong and stopping the evil. And those that were even from that tribe, but were Muslims and defended the man who were not a part of the crime, were not harmed. To show the fairness of Islam. And here inshallah, we'll end this and the letters of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We end the durus on that, going forward towards the events, towards some of the battles and the fatah of Mecca coming up inshallah ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khairan.